experience. Whereas just a mere exposure to society and doing some other peripheral work is known as knowledge. And realization is known as wisdom, and mere memorization is known as knowledge, which we are doing now. So it should have some taste of joy, it should have ease and comfort. These are all the various benefits of wisdom and knowledge. Now, how to promote this knowledge into wisdom will be dealt in a very big seminar which is exclusively meant for that. Not only because of paucity of the time, but also by the intensity of our desire as well as the intensified mechanism of widermost things that are hidden in the deep abysmal core of this knowledge. It requires dates of discuss and months of practice and years to go for penance for achievement. So number two, like we are getting, that's why somebody told, knowledge is given but wisdom is gained. Wherever we teach something, I am speaking here. It is just given to you. But if you operate it inside your inner mind and get the benefits of same thing, so the first step is known as knowledge. Knowledge is the next step to ignorance, whereas wisdom is the previous step to success or attainment. Wisdom is the previous step to success or attainment, and knowledge is the next step to nescience or ignorance. That's what they have clearly told about these things. And whenever we come to various other things, we have to understand different tempers already, because we are doing a working project on BREAS, breeding of young scientists. How we can breed young scientists, like they are breeding with the crocodile farm, snake farm, everything they are doing except for human beings, and for talented human beings and humane human beings, except this, everything is bred on our endangered species. The first endangered species are a real, valuable, noble, humble human being is the most endangered species. Why we are not doing that? That we have to concentrate more. So, breeding young scientists, there are seven tempers. I want to say something. One science seminar I addressed, everybody started off not conducting the seminar henceforth or not calling me henceforth for the seminar. Number one, there is innovative temper. Second is creative temper. Third thing is imitative temper. Fourth thing is adaptative temper. Fifth is operative temper. Sixth is inceptive temper. Seventh is deceptive temper. Indian science, or whatever you call, most of the things are imitative, adaptative and operative. Innovative intelligence and creative intelligence is very less in India. No doubt we are proud of few scientists like Chandrasekhar, Raman and other people. But that is totally insufficient. So we are taming people who can work for the development of other countries and other technologies, and we are just having a pseudo pride that we are developing in science instead of thinking that we are developing somebody else at the cost of our sacrifice and services. And we are not realizing that. These seven tempers are there. Once we have to conduct a seminar on education about methodologies and ancient tools for developing innovative and creative intelligence, we have to work at all. And there are two divisions of education. One is conceptive history and expansion. If you read about the conceptive history of the previous inventions, inventors and various other things, you have to get into expansion by means of three types of learning. One is relearning, second is unlearning, third is learning. So these arts are not there. How to relearn the thing so that it can be stamped? How to learn the thing properly? See, to read is different from studying. To study is entirely different from learning. To learn is entirely different from realizing. To realize is entirely different from relishing. To relish is different from attaining. To attain is different from distinguishing. These type of various hierarchies of knowledge should be properly understood. Only this is possible by Vedic wisdom. So these two phases of conceptive history and expansion of the conceptive history into contemporary studies and futuristic expansions that can be made possible only by these unlearning, learning and relearning techniques. Education requires three instigatory methods. One is interest. Second is involvement. Third thing is identity. I'm interested in studying this. This is my interest. I am totally studying only this. That is involvement. I am not separable. I am not feeling myself somewhat different or distinguishable from this content. I am identical. This is possible in cinemas. This is possible in cricket shows. This is possible in all the other filthy unwanted exercises. In all the unwanted things, identity is there. Unless the person is identical with the knowledge, with the syllabus, with the teacher, with the spirit of wisdom, they cannot get real knowledge. It is only a daydream for everybody. So they are getting, even interest is lacking now. How to say about involvement and identity, characteristic identity and conceptive identity, how you can get these things? It is just miraculous. Normal incidental achievements have become very miraculous now. So how to get this? Because the Shastras say very simply, if you are attached towards the cinema, cricket or any other attraction, any other peripheral, ephemeral, infra-unstructural alluration, wherever you are attached to, why it is happening and why it is happening, In ephemeral things or filthy things, why is this happening in education, realization and advanced things? The Shastra says that whenever you want to go to something which is filthy, it is downward motion, it does not require anything because there is a natural gravity of attraction towards inferior and filthy sources. If you want to climb superior, then it requires a compression. It should come from you or from your model, your radiant model of your teacher, a spiritual saint, or a very great committed person from the society. That should be a role model from the society. Living role model, loving role model, deep-hearted, deep-rooted, deep-seated role model should be there inside you. Then only you can get all of these benefits. So, what is this? Why we are calling this a school and what is the purpose of this education syllabus? Education is the art to educe a person's inner craving for knowledge in the form of interest to mature into the process of involvement and to fructify into identity is the work of a school. That is why there is a system made, there is a structure made. It starts with everything six S we used to call it as. One is a place where there is environmental conduciveness, there you can develop interest into involvement and identity. That environment is known as a school. And the particular discipline where you are going to focus, that is known as a syllabus. And the particular area where you are going to cover is known as a subject. And the methodology by which you will be examined, experimented, and you will be uploaded with the knowledge, that is known as system. And the person who is going to do that is a scholar, the receptacle is known as a student. So, this type of ideology of getting the involvement and identity from mere interest has resulted in the form of school, the subject, the syllabus, the system, the scholar and student. It is the real birth or it is the Janma Kundali of the school technology or the school methodology which is available now. This is the proper way of understanding that. What is the difference between present system and previous system? In previous systems, we were having four people: Acharya, Shishya, Vidya and Jnana. Now we are not having those things. Acharya is different from a teacher. Shishya is different from a student. Vidya is different from syllabus or subject. Jnana is different from knowledge. Entirely they are different. What is the capability of an Acharya? Acharya has few capabilities. Number one, an Acharya has a distant influence capability. From the house he can command. Now even before the classroom he cannot command. So distant influence. Distant influence is the power of a spiritual master. And number two, a person who can be capable in doing two things. One is modeling, second is molding. You be like that, then make the person like that. That is modeling and molding the person. Then instigation and implantation of all of these things. Then without any speech, in silence and inertia, one who can conduct the classes, he is having the transmission authority, he is an Acharya. Acharya, by his vision, by his touch, by his remote wish, by his kripa drishti, by his clemential extension of optical or sensory visions and visuals, the person can deeply influence a person and bring him wisdom. That person is a very great person and he should have also the capability of creating a bondage. He should implant the devotional attachment or preeti within the disciples. He should have the courage as well as the capability to create a bondage with the child till it is subjected to the funeral rites. So that is an Acharya. So Acharya has the powers of transmission, distant influence, implantation and instigation, modeling and molding as well as creating a bondage. And second, Shishya. Shishya is a person who should have the quality of viewing. What is viewing? He must be just blank. Now the people, they are just blank. Even if everything is given, they are blank. They don't see anything at all. So now viewing is to view something in addition with what the teacher has told and what he has understood. It is known as imaginary engineering. He should be an imaginary engineer, number one. Number two, he should have trans-operational skills or trans-cognitive skills. He should not be just a bookworm. More than that, he should have the trans-cognitive skill. He should have also a contemplative and inspirational model. Whom he worships is known as a contemplative model, like Hayagriva or Vishnu Narayana. Inspiration model may be a very great scholar, saint, stalwart, or anybody available that. And a person should possess culture. What is culture? Culture is the expansion of human mind where he thinks and links about others when he is attempting to grow. Culture is defined as the art of expanding his mind. It is the magnanimity to think and link others in his process of growth. That is known as culture. And I want to say about one culture, Uttara and Uttama. If you learn, if you get knowledge, that is Ut. If you give knowledge to others, that is uttara. If you establish an institution where perennially knowledge is available to everybody relentlessly, that is uttama kritya. So the best culture is to establish an educational institution which can produce any number of people. Educational institution can produce God people, godly people, God-like people, God-sent people, and even